Penguin Random House Audio presents The Policeman's Daughter by Trudy Nan Boyce. Read for you by Allyson Ryan. I am saying that a journey is called that because you cannot know what you will discover on the journey, what you will do with what you find, or what you find will do to you. James Baldwin. Chapter 1. Improper Crossing of the Gore. They were always close to hard times. So she and Pepper invented a game to play before the calls piled up. Beginning of shift, late afternoon, before the zone began to bust up, before the adrenaline hours, they ran from roll call, scrambling to get to their Crown Vicks, eager to get a traffic case on some obscure charge. The winner would be the first one to have written at least one ticket for each of the violations in the traffic code. Running her finger down the worn list, Salt had made all the easy ones 100 times over. Stop sign, failure to yield, improper equipment. And she had made the harder ones, A through H. Her favorite so far was the lewd bumper sticker case she had made last week. Fuck up, it had read. Improper crossing of the gore was on her agenda for the afternoon. If she could make this one, she'd keep her slight lead on Pepper. After shift, on the nights he had ticketed for some obscure infraction, Pepper would make his entrance to the precinct, giving her the business and calling himself Hot Pepper, inviting the rest of the cops to rain insults. Pepper playing straight to the champions of put-down. I am black and proud and red hot tonight, he said, pimp walking into the precinct, underscoring his street name. Now, idling on the expressway, Salt sat parked beside an entrance ramp wall, watching for a gore violation. The vibrations of the concrete ramp beside her reverberated to her hand on the gear arm. Hearing Pepper on her shoulder mic calling out a tractor-trailer rig stop, she could imagine some weird tonnage charge he'd be carrying on about at shift change. Highway dirt blew up from a ragged hole in the passenger side floorboard. A fine dust coated her arms and everything in the car, one of the Atlanta Police Department's finest vehicles. The city was playing its budget games again this year, this season with the police vehicle acquisition contract. Still smiling at the thought of Hot Pepper, she saw a Maxima come shooting from the entrance ramp, sending roadside trash whirling, its draft rocking the patrol car. The driver ignored the thatched lines of the Gore Island and had to brake sharply before he was able to pull into Atlanta's fragile, rule-dependent, rush-hour commuter derby. As improper a crossing as it gets, she declared out loud, as she hit the blue lights and fell in behind the violator, calling the stop. Radio, hold me out southbound on the downtown connector at Fulton Street on a late model black Maxima, New York tag 1 X-ray Mary 225, occupied one time, white male driver. The car pulled slowly into the emergency lane, the driver seeming uncertain, brake lights on, off, his silhouette leaning right. Her foot copied his, on the brakes, on the gas, off, on. She followed him 100 yards or so until he pulled to a stop in the right emergency lane. Beginning of rush hour was always the most dangerous. Traffic just fast enough so that accidents occurring at the higher speeds were more injurious. She stepped out of the cruiser, hypervigilant of the roaring freeway on her left. An 18-wheeler's big tires, head high, whooshed close. Speeding cars in a hot wind swirled dust and debris across 14 lanes. She put her hand up to shield her eyes as she approached the Maxima. Muscle memory took over, coming up close on the rear of the driver's side, touching the trunk with her entire palm flat on the warm metal, watching the barely visible print evaporate. The oils from her body could be evidence if a driver made a run for it. The safety films at the academy had perps hiding there, ready to spring out. Make sure the trunk is latched. She pressed the lid, but in the noise of the traffic, which wasn't in the training film, couldn't be certain what she heard. Something? A click? She moved to stand just behind the driver's window, and leaning down, began a polite, "Sir, the reason I stopped you is because you merged illegally, crossing the Gore." The driver, about 40 years old, didn't look at her, but stared straight ahead, his large hands hovering over the steering wheel.
"I crossed what?"
His lips were badly chapped, pieces of skin peeling off with some tiny, fresh, bloody spots. "The Gore. The diagonal lines between the ramp lane and the traffic lane. Can I see your license and proof of insurance?" His jaw muscles clenched beneath gray, stubbled cheeks.
"You stopped me for crossing some lines?"
She focused on his hands. On the back of his left hand was a fuzzed line tattoo of a joker with the hat points on the knuckles, a jail-type tattoo of blue-gray ink. "Sir," checking the interior of the car. "Sir, do you have your license?"
"You stopped me for that?"
The points of the hat spread as his fingers tightened around the steering wheel. "Sir, it's a violation."
"I apologize, officer. I didn't know it was against the law."
"May I see your driver's license?" There was a can of carburetor cleaner and a black case on the passenger seat.
"I said I was sorry. Give me a break."
His eyes were on hers as it registered, all wrong. Carburetor cleaner for a new car? No, carburetor cleaner. The lazy man's gun cleaner. The black case. "Sir, do you have your license?"
"Look, officer."
He was beginning to spit his words.
"I pulled over. I apologized for breaking a tiny rule that I didn't know existed. Now why don't you give me a fucking break?"
She'd already heard it in his voice anyway. His wires crossed, now pulled too tight. A jailhouse joker, a convict. Now they both knew he couldn't con her. His right hand went to his jacket. Backing away, she reached for her weapon, unsnapping the safety strap, fast drawing. "Radio, start me another." Before she could finish the transmission, he was moving, opening the car door. She backed toward her cruiser, seeking cover, careful of the rubble of the freeway under her boots. As quickly, before she could get to the car, he was out of the Maxima, both arms in a shooting stance, short barrel, a glint of fire. The world slowed, the expressway faded, and the sounds of traffic were gone. She saw gray-white smoke from her gun, saw the rounds entering the blue cloth of his shirt, and watched as he fell backward in the blowing dirt. Then there was only her own breathing and the weight of her weapon. Like a phone ringing in someone else's house, radio was calling, 3306, 3306. 3306!
3306.
Her mouth formed words, but she couldn't hear them. Still in tactical mode, her focus was on the driver, though he had to be dead. She had clearly seen the rounds entering exactly where his heart should be. She moved closer to him, slowly, still pointing the nine, keeping the sights trained, her eyes gritty from the flying dirt, and not blinking. She kicked his weapon away, breathing heavy, her mouth open, smelling and tasting gunpowder. The stream of time eddied and broke as she pointed her gun at the motionless man. Eventually, she dropped her arms to a waist-high position. Then Pepper was there, calling out as he ran up, "Salt! Salt!" He touched her shoulder. Only then did she holster, but the wind had blown something into her eyes, making it hard for her to see. Pepper took her elbow and made a cradle with his arm, guiding her down to the dirt-coated asphalt.
Radio, 3306 has been shot. Ambulance, code 3.
She wanted to tell him it was okay, but she got distracted trying to clear her sight.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.